the monetary value of gross domestic product and we divide it by the population of a country, we obtain GDP per capita. And given that GDP measures also total income, GDP per capita is a proxy of the average individual income. This is why GDP is also used to measure the standards of living of a country and to consider how many goods and services a citizen of a given country can afford and can use. So GDP per capita is also an approximation of living standards and consumption levels. Of course, it's not a perfect measure, it's only a proxy. But it's useful to remember that even if it measures only economic conditions, GDP includes the availability of health and education services, the availability of housing, access to transportation, and so on. So it provides an overall picture of what citizens of a given country can use. In general, on average, people in a country with a high GDP, and especially with high GDP per capita, are better off than people living in a country with a low level of GDP per capita. Clearly, the measure of GDP per capita, taken as we described, is not considering the distribution of income. So we would need to include this to actually have a better measurement of standards of living. But given the importance of GDP to take into account the well-being of a country and of people living in that country, it's important to understand why some countries have a high level of GDP and others have a low level of GDP. To understand why some countries have a high level of GDP and others have a low level of GDP, we need to consider determinants of GDP. And it's important to distinguish between long-term determinants and short-term determinants because they are quite different. In the long term, determinants of GDP are given by the amount of factors of production that a country can use, the amount of physical capital, the labor force available, the amount of land. And these are sheer measures of size of a country. We also need to consider the technology that a country can use to produce and combine these factors of production. Change over time of these components, the amount of factors available, the improvement in the technology, can increase output and increase the level of GDP over time. Therefore, GDP growth in the long run is determined by the accumulation of factors and by technological progress. Both these phenomena rely on investment. Investment in physical capital, building up the capital stock, investment in human capital, learning how to use the capabilities of people, and investment in improving the technology. These are things that take time, investment requires time, and this is why these are determinants of growth in the long run. In general, GDP in the long run grows for most countries, so we have an upward trend in GDP, even if this trend is very different for different countries. The maximum level of GDP that a country can produce at a given moment in time, given the technology at that moment and the factors of production available at that moment, it's called the potential GDP or full employment GDP. And this is the amount of GDP corresponding to the level of production reached using the state-of-the-art technology and employing all available factors of production. In the short run, the potential or maximum level of GDP is stable given technology and given the factors of production. But the actual amount of GDP that we observe can change. We are not always in the short run producing at the maximum level, and we therefore observe yearly fluctuations of GDP, even if the technology does not change and the amount of factors of production is stable. In the short run, the GDP level is given by how much firms choose to produce rather than can produce, and this is not necessarily the maximum possible amount that can be produced using all factors of production and having full employment. These ideas can be encompassed in a model that we can try now to visualize.